Okay, well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. The joy of the Lord is upon us. It's great to see you here this morning. Thank you so much for making time to be in worship together this day. I'm Doug Albertson. I serve this great church, and I have the pleasure, truly indeed, heartfelt pleasure, to have you help me in welcoming our dear friend, guest pastor Dave Slorp here this morning. Blessings on us in many ways. Pastor Blake and his family had the big wedding yesterday of their son Matthew, and we're just thrilled that Dave was willing to step forward, not only for us here, but for the 8 o'clock and the 11 o'clock. Just like old times, David. Just like old times. Well, I hope you'll stick around after church and join us for some coffee and donuts. It's always a treat, part of our morning, part of our social time, but also part of our fellowship time. Say hello to one another after church. We do have those pew pads along the center aisle. We sure appreciate you letting us know you're here. It is a regular part of our church life each week to see your name signed in there. We appreciate that. And hopefully, too, you've taken a minute to kind of look through your bulletins and kind of get oriented. I'm going to focus on two announcements. I'm going to give the first one short and fast. The second one I'm going to talk about in a minute. The first one is today is the last Sunday of the month. And we know that that means that what follows the last Sunday of every month is the first Sunday of the month, which of course means communion for us. It also means we bring in our coin banks, which always is important, and we appreciate you bringing in your loose change. We bring in food for the fish. Our food ministry is called Fish. I was down there this week. They're going through a lot of food, so you could be thinking about grabbing up those dry goods, non-perishables. And it also means the fellowship luncheon, which has become quite a thing. We started that, some of the folks started that. I came and ate. And you could do the same. You could come and eat. We start with a handful of people. There's probably 70 or 80 people now who come. It's a nice fellowship time, and it's one of the few, maybe even the only time that regularly occurs where members from of the congregation from Stony Point, 8 o'clock, 9:30, they all come, the Fijian communities, they all come to one time. How about that for a chance to be together as a great community of this church? So we'd love to see you there. And then the other announcement, which is really the one that I wanted to especially stress, is the last day for us to talk about it. It's the upcoming golf benefit and dinner. I know it's called a golf tournament, but let's face it, there ain't gonna be a lot of tournament play going on in this particular round. At least not in my group. I know I got some of the guys that are here this morning. We play for fun. We play for fun. And it's set up that way. We have to turn registrations in. We have a handful of foursomes. We thought we'd have more. Honestly, we thought we'd have more. I think we've learned that maybe we're not a golfing community as much as we thought we were. We might have been in the old days, but we apparently aren't as much now. We've got four or five groups that have signed up. We'd love to obviously get up to 20. That's what we were shooting for. But hey, we're not going to do that this year, it looks like. But we can still take more today. You got to fill out this form. Now, I do know one thing we are, and that is an eating community. I have seen you people. You can do meals as good as, if not better than most, and there's still a chance to get in on the dinner. Now, here's a little insider's information. The proceeds from the dinner are actually significant. We can help raise more money for the church by going to the dinner than you think, because that $25 donation, a significant chunk of it goes to the church. And you got to eat on Friday night, and there's still time to get reservations in, right, Elizabeth? This is your form. Mine's green. Is yours green this morning? They're all green. How appropriate, right? Putting green. So out of the rough, golf tournament and dinner. And dinner. It's barbecue dinner, huh? And there's a silent auction there, which is all pure proceeds for the church. Remember, we're raising money for the budget and our campership program. So we'd love to have you come out and join us. If you haven't decided yet, well, by golly, decide now. Come out and join us. We'd love to see you there. We'll be there. I hope you'll be there, too, to join us. It's this Friday. Last thing I get to say about that is there. Let's take a minute before we begin our worship. Let's stand and greet each other and say hello in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to one another. indeed, dear Lord. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. To wake up feeling your blessings upon us, to gather in this community and to feel your blessings upon us, to be a part of this greater community around us and to feel your blessings upon us. We give you thanks for the blessings that you have showed in our lives, you continue to show each day that we walk. And we ask you in your name, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to be with us now and always. Amen. And speaking of blessings, Elizabeth Walton is here this morning, and she's got a children's time. Boys and girls, just come on forward. I see a baseball somewhere, which always gets my attention.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. So, a question. Oh, we're friends. Come on, guys. Good morning. So, at my house, we have a little bit of a love of sports. Does anybody else have a love of sports? Yes. What? No other people, and no other loves of sports. What kind of sports teams do you know about? Oh, okay, so soccer, Amber. What other kind of sports are there?
Football.
Baseball. Baseball, of course. Any other teams? Basketball, cricket, good. Lots and lots of different kind of sports.
Hockey.
But hockey, awesome. Today, you know, there's all sorts of times. Today, brought the baseball just because that seems to be the strongest sport in our house, at least. And it's definitely got a love of a lot of our attentions here. So anyway, so can you guys tell me a little bit about baseball, a little bit about the rules of baseball, maybe?
Just give me one idea of baseball. What do you do?
If you look like you're gonna pitch and then you throw back to a base, that's called a balk.
Okay. All right, good. All right, so we've got some of that. Okay, so he does play. Yes, okay, I told you we spend a lot of time on baseball. So, you know, so basically the ball gets thrown to you, you hit it with a stick, a bat, you know, something like that. You try to run around bases, just general rules, right? So anywhere in the rules of baseball or any other sport, is there anything about you must celebrate when you score?
No.
Is that written?
No.
No. Oh. But do people do that?
Yeah.
Oh. And have you ever, like, maybe even in football, especially in football, I've seen it a lot. Do you see, like, when they spike the ball and they're like, yeah, I'm number one, right? Do we ever see that? And they're, like, just.
I have no idea what that is.
You have no idea what. My goodness, some unsporty people. Yeah, see, they do the kind of, you saw that, huh? Yeah, like the kind of the crazy, over the top, you know, kind of excited, I'm the best. Really? You know what? That's never written. That's kind of something that is in people's hearts. They say, like, oh, I just did the best. But is it a team sport?
No.
Sometimes, yeah, a lot of this time. And you kind of want to just, you know, maybe not be so centered on yourself. So the scripture that we're going to talk about today is one of the most famous scriptures. I'm going to ask you to read this today.
Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself.
From Matthew.
Matthew 22, verse 36 through 39.
Excellent. So when you hear that, do you hear that as God's telling us to love just ourselves and say, yes, I'm number one, I made the score, I did the touchdown, I made the run? Is that God saying that?
Or is he saying, you know what? It's great for you to do something, you know, love yourself, but then love who else? Love who else? What was that last part of it? Love your
neighbors
as yourself. So is it okay to be happy and cheerful when you've done a good thing?
Yeah.
Is it better to share that with your neighbors?
Yeah.
Loving them as yourself? Absolutely. We're going to talk a little bit more about that upstairs. Let's head on up after we say our prayer. Dear Father, help us to love ourselves, loving you as much as we have loved ourselves, learning from you the love that you have shared with us first, loving ourselves, and then sharing that love throughout the world, every person we ever meet. In your name we pray. Amen.
My name is Joanne, and I'm going to do a song called You Raise Me Up that Josh Groban made famous a number of years ago, and it's been done by several other people also. When I am down and oh my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burdened be, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulder. You raise me up to more than I can be. There is no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. Thank you.
more than I can be. You raise me up to more than I can be.
Good morning. Our scripture reading this morning is from the book of Genesis, chapter 12, verses 1 through 4, the call of Abram. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will become a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran.
Please be seated. You sound good. I think the Baptists could hear us today down there. That's kind of messing up their service. Good for us. Beautiful song, Joanna. Thank you so much. It fits right into our topic today. It's great to see you. It's such a joy to be here and have this privilege of sharing some words with you and seeing familiar faces and seeing your faces from the front. You know. Because I'm in the pew more now, and so I see the backs of your head. But you are actually beautiful now that I see you in person. So it's just great. And I appreciate Pastor Blake giving me this opportunity, and Lindsay, and we know our thoughts and prayers are with them this morning. Please join me in our prayer of openness. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Well, folks, I'm thinking of three words today. I'm going to give you some clues. And don't say anything when you think, I'll let you in on when we're going to say it together. See if you can get it. Sometimes we say these three words when someone sneezes. Yeah, sometimes we say this when we're saying goodbye to a loved one. These three words are very important words. Sometimes we write a letter, we write that down, these three words. And sometimes when a pastor's real busy and needs to kind of say goodbye to a parishioner quickly without seeming offensive, so he has to, or she has to get to a meeting, the pastor may say this. What are those three words together? God bless you. That's right. So if I give you a quick God bless you, you know I had to get off to a meeting somewhere. Oh, gosh. You know, the Bible is full of blessings. People are giving blessings, but mostly God is giving blessings. And the interesting thing about it is whenever God gives a blessing, God asks us to be blessings in return. The blessed give blessings to others. Blessed to be a blessing. Blessed to be a blessing. In the book of Genesis, Norm read this for us today. We have the call of God to Abram. Later he'd be called Abraham, the same guy. Abraham and Sarah. He would become the father of many nations. That's what God says. So this is the father of the Muslims. We have this in common, you know. The Christians and the Jews, we all see Abram as our spiritual forefather. And in this text, God has a startling request. I mean, this is crazy. Abram and Sarah have a perfectly fine life. They're living rent-free in her father's house. I mean, how can you beat something like that? They're eating well. They are comfortable. They're 75. They're enjoying their pensions. It's great. And then God has the audacity to break into their comfortable life and say, I need you. I'm going to bless you. Well, that sounds pretty good. But you're going to be a blessing, and the way you're going to do that is to leave your home, your relatives, all the comfortable things, and take off to a country that I will tell you about pretty soon, later on. Right now, just get going. Sometimes God says that to us, right? Just take the first step. Just get going, and details will be made known. Well, I imagine that Abraham checked his iPhone, and the Siri didn't know where on earth God was taking them, so that was not helpful at all. Turn your back on that cushy life. Now, folks, Abram was 75 years old. His wife was 65. So I'm just warning you, someday, if any of you reach the age of 75, you're not done. Watch out. God may be coming to your door and giving you a great challenge. So here they were, blessed to be a blessing. We remember the wonderful baptism of Jesus. You have the setting on the River Jordan. You have this kind of crazy prophet, John the Baptizer. Now, I call him John the Baptizer. Why do I do that? I don't like to call him John the Baptist. That gives the Baptist kind of an edge. You know? Why should we give publicity to the Baptist? I'm just kidding. You don't say John the Methodist, you know, John the Presbyterian. So, John the Baptizer, and Jesus comes, and some would say this is kind of the riffraff of society gathered out there in this desert wilderness with this crazy prophet, and Jesus comes and says, I want to be baptized. I want to have your blessing. And so we have this picture of John the Baptizer baptizing Jesus, probably there, and putting his face in the water, his whole body, and coming up refreshed and renewed, and the voice of God comes, this is my son, in whom I am well pleased. What a great thing to have said about you. And Jesus hears this at the beginning of his ministry. You notice here that heaven is very close, dear ones. Heaven is not way off somewhere. In other words, God's presence is very close to us in whom we live and move and have our being. I have a little fun with this song by Bette Midler, From a Distance. You know that song, God is watching us. God is watching us. God is watching us from a distance. And when God is so far up there that God can't see well. And so from where God looks, there are no borders and nor wars or anything like that. It's kind of a silly song theologically. Because God knows very well what's going on in our world. And it's not from a distance. It's from intimate knowledge in the pain and the hopes and the struggles of people throughout the world. So, Bette, I love you. I actually love that song. I actually listened to it the other day. It actually brought some tears to my eyes, just like this song, Joanna, you sang so beautifully today. That brings tears to my eyes, too. But just theology is an F, okay? I'm just going to give that an F. The heavens open up. You are my beloved son. The dove even comes to kind of double the blessing. And then that's a launching pad for Jesus. And one of the first things he does is he goes to his home church, his home synagogue, and they say, here comes Jesus. He was in the MYF. He was in the children's choir. He was great. And he's come back to preach to us today. Can't wait to hear what he's going to say. And so Jesus comes, he opens the scroll of Isaiah, and it's this powerful image that Isaiah gives us. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. The Lord has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor, sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. I love that. To proclaim liberty to the captives, the people who are captive, not in prisons, but emotionally and relationally and all those kind of ways. And to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. And that's a nice sermon. You're ready to take the offering. And then Jesus says something that turns the whole thing on its head. He says, this has been fulfilled in your hearing. I am that guy. And the people, their mouths, did he say what I think he said? He thinks he is that guy. That little guy I had in Sunday school, that little guy in MYF, he thinks he's the fulfillment of this. And Jesus says, yes, I am. Now, you know the rest of the story. It doesn't go too well at this synagogue. They're ready to throw him over the cliff, you know. I always am careful about what I say because I saw that as a precedent. But anyway, Jesus did exactly what he said, didn't he? He blessed people who never felt blessed. He loved people who never felt loved. He healed the brokenhearted. He helped people feel closer to God. It was amazing what he did. Jesus was blessed, and out of that blessing, he became a blessing to others, to all of us. You know, my mother, when I was a teenager and I'd leave the house, maybe off on a date or something, she'd say, David, you be a blessing. I wasn't quite sure what she meant by that. You know, did I look that terrible or going to go to some dastardly deed or something like that? But I think I get it now. Be a blessing. How can you make the situation in your school or wherever it was better? Folks, when Christ touches us, we're given a mission, and you know that. We're given a job, all ages, regardless of whether we're young or whether we're older. And we begin to see people as we put on the goggles of Jesus. You've gone in the ocean or in the lake, and you can't see things very well till you put on those swim goggles. And then suddenly it becomes clear. Those are Jesus' goggles that we put on. And when we put those on, we begin to see the world, begin to see people differently, in a different light. We see the value in other human beings that we might have missed. We begin to see that they matter to God. We remember the beautiful story of John Newton, a slave trader, born in 1725, a little bit after John Wesley. John Wesley, 1703, so a little bit younger. But he was a slave trader, captain of a big slave ship. And a terrible guy. Did terrible things to human beings. One time he was in a storm, and He felt God saved him. I don't know why it takes a storm so often to get people on the right course, but it happened for John Newton. And slowly, I say slowly, not right away, he began to see that what he was doing was a terrible thing, to be a slave trader. And so ultimately became a leader for the abolitionist movement in England and got slave trade done. He had Jesus goggles. And what song did he write? Of course, Amazing Grace. I once was lost, but now I'm found. What's the next part? Was blind, but now I see. Now I see. I've got those Jesus goggles on. Some years ago, there was a movie that I saw. It's just a short film. Probably none of you saw it. But it was called Cypher in the Snow. And we know Cypher means a person of no worth, a non-entity, really. And in this movie, there's a school bus and has school kids being taken to their home. And one boy gets out, probably around 11 or 12 years of age. He kind of stumbles out of the school bus. And when he steps out, he collapses on the snow. And people rush over to see how he is. And amazingly, he has died. He just died right there in the snow. And they said, well, why? And who is he? Why did this terrible thing happen? They talked to the teachers. And the teachers, they knew him, yes, but he was no trouble. He kind of got C grades. He didn't stand out. Wasn't that great? Wasn't that bad? He kind of off to the side. Kids weren't particularly mean to him. They just didn't pay much attention to him. And so he was kind of in the playground all by himself most of the time. They looked into his home situation. They found out that his father especially was very abusive. He could never do anything right. Everything he did was wrong. And so finally, after all this analysis and checking things out, they said he died of a broken heart. He just died of a broken heart. Bruce Larson, in one of his books, says, life breaks down not so much because of terrible things that happen to us. Life breaks down because so few good things happen to us. What a shame. You know, it's tremendously important, and you know this, that our kids feel they're blessed by us, that they are special, that they're of worth, that they're loved by God and they're loved by us. Those powerful words, I am proud of you. Those are big words. I love you. Those are big words. And sometimes, depending on the culture we've been brought up in, it's hard to say that. I remember, you know, being a pastor here in this church, and we do a lot of hugging, you know how it goes? And so I thought, you know, that's great. And so, I don't hug my dad. You know, so one time I said, well, that's silly. I hug my mom. I don't hug my dad. What are we, big macho guys? And I hugged him, big hug. He about melted like an icicle in the desert. It was just too much for him, you know. It was his culture. But we've got a breakthrough, not necessarily that, but breakthrough to be able to say, I love you. And that can happen even if our kids are 50 or 60. They need, don't you think, to hear that message again and again. We desperately need people who communicate that kind of love to all of us, that we matter. You know, we all want to be seen. I think most of us want to be seen and acknowledged and affirmed. My drama coach in college used to set us up. He said, now, when there's a group picture being taken, and it may go in the newspaper, you get right down in the front right-hand side over there like that. Here's the group over here. Because when it comes out in the newspaper, they'll say, reading bottom row left to right, and your name will appear first. Well, that's kind of overboard. But we want to be seen and known. You know, Jan and I have the joy of being grandparents. You know, our granddaughter, Jordan, is about 3 and a half. Now, she should be 13 and a half. I mean, you know, I feel like Abram and Sarah, you know, sometimes with our granddaughter. But she's, of course, great. But she likes to be seen. And so when we FaceTime or some of you Skype, same kind of thing, she says, Grandma, watch me dance. Grandpa, watch me do the hula hoop. And look, see what I made. We say, oh, it's great. It's great. We love it, you know. She could put hanky in the disposal can, and we'd say, wonderful job, you know. I mean, affirming, yes, sir, affirming, you know. She's so funny because her name is Jordan, and Jan and I thought we'd like a special name for her from us, Jory. We thought, that's fun, you know, it's a happy sound, Jory. So we've been calling her Jory these 3.5 years. And she finally got up the gumption to say she doesn't like it. Because she's writing out Jordan, you know. She doesn't see any Jory. I don't see it when I write it out there. So she got up the gumption to say to me, Grandpa, don't call me Jordan. And it wasn't, please don't call me. That comes later, right? Please tell me that comes later. Grandpa, don't call me Jordan. Don't call me Jory. My name is Jordan. I don't call you Grampy. She wins. Well, she wants to be seen and to know, and she wants us to know her name properly, too. One basketball coach said to his players, when one of the teammates you're playing with feeds you the ball and you go make a basket with that ball, you turn and say, thank you, appreciate it. And one guy said, what if he's not looking at you? And the coach says, he'll be looking at you. He'll be looking for that acknowledgement. Bob Benson is one of Jan and my favorite authors. One of the books we like of his is called Come Share the Being. Not bean. Come Share the Being. And he shares this story. I just love this guy, so earthy. He says, it was a bright, sunshiny morning, the first day of 10 days off for me. I was out in the yard early, working on a wall down at the lake, knee-deep in the pleasant, warm water. I could hardly have been happier or more at peace. Patrick came down and began to throw rocks in the water. You don't have to teach little boys to throw rocks. They just seem to be born with both the skill and desire. He wanted me to stop and to play with him. Teach me how to make them skip, Dad. In a little while, I said, let me get a little more of this wall built. After a while, he got tired of waiting, and he started up the hill to the house. Well, I figured he'd be back in a few minutes, but later in the morning when I went up for a drink, he was in bed with a high fever. It turned out to be a very serious illness that spread through the whole family, and not to mention our vacation. It took some of us to the hospital. In the long run, we came through with no lingering effects. And there have been other days and other chances to skip rocks with Pack. But I can still see him trudging up that hill, a long pull for his short little legs. And I'm reminded that you never know when they're coming back. There aren't any guarantees. And the only time you really know you can skip rocks is when you're saying, in a little while. One older woman in one of the churches that I serve said, you know, as I get older, I seem to become more invisible. I'm not as interesting somehow, I guess. And many of the folks there were younger families. Someone found this in a nursing home after a person had died from one of the residents. She left nothing of value, but as going through the things that she had, they found this poem. I'll share this with you. What do you see, nurses? What do you see? What are you thinking when you're looking at me? A crabby old woman, not very wise, uncertain of habit, with faraway eyes. I'm a small child of 10 with a mother and a father, brothers and sisters who love one another. A bride in her 20s, my heart gives a leap, remembering the vow I promised to keep. A woman of 30, my young now grown fast, bound to each other with ties that will last. At 40, my sons have grown and have gone, but my man is beside me. I don't seem to mourn. At 50, once more, babies play around my knee. Again, we know children, my husband and me. I'm an old woman now, and nature is cruel. It is her jest to make old age look like a fool. The body, it crumbles. Grace and vigor depart. There's now a stone where I once had a heart. But inside this old carcass, a young girl still dwells. And now and again, my battered heart swells, and I remember the joys, I remember the pains, and I'm loving and living life over again. I think of all the years, all too few, gone too fast, and accept the stark fact that nothing can last. So open your eyes, nurses. Open and see, not a feeble old woman. Look closer. See me. Jesus did that, didn't he? He really saw people through the eyes of love, regardless of who they were, what age they were. I think of that great story, I love it, of De Niro, Robert De Niro. That's the guy I'm thinking of. Isn't that short little actor? Isn't that the name of that guy? Jan, who am I thinking of?
Are you talking about Midnight Cowboy?
No, the guy that looks like he's a short comic little figure. He was in, who? Yeah, that's right. I'm so good with names. The only thing I say is, I probably never could have come up with that name, but he's Zacchaeus, right? I mean, if there's going to be a person that plays Zacchaeus, he should play Zacchaeus. I can just see the tree kind of bending when he gets up there. But you know Zacchaeus, you know, tax collector, cheated his neighbors out of their money. He's just an awful kind of guy. And he climbs up a tree. I think he climbs up physically, also climbs up emotionally, I think. The people didn't want to be around him, so he's up there where he can get a safe place and get a shot of Jesus. And Jesus comes into that village, and of all the people there, of so many who said, "See me, Jesus," I'm sure Jesus saw them, but he saw somebody who really needed him. This funny guy up in the tree, object of abuse by his neighbors. And he said, "Zacchaeus, I want to have lunch with you." Might have been a big smile on Jesus' face. And Zacchaeus says, "You want to have lunch with me?" And the crowd says, "You want to have lunch with him?" It's kind of, you could do a kind of a comedy out of this kind of thing. Just keep going. He says, "Yes." And we don't know what happened when they had lunch together, but I'm sure that Zacchaeus began to see that he could be a different kind of person, that he was a person of worth. He didn't act like he did, and he became new, a new person. That's what Jesus does with the eyes of Jesus. Some of you have read the works of Henry Nguyen. He's a Catholic priest born in Holland around 1933. He had a great mind. He had a warm heart. He wrote over 40 books, theological books and other kinds of books. He was a smart guy. He taught at some pretty good schools, Yale, Harvard, Notre Dame. Those are pretty good schools, don't you think? And he taught there, so highly respected. So it was amazing when he said, "Now for my last 15 years in the active ministry, I'm going to become a priest and counselor at a group home for adults with special needs." And that's what he did. And so he tells about his experiences working with his people. They could have no respect for his intellect. You know, he didn't get any rewards for that. They could only get respect for his heart, which he had in abundance. And he tells the story of one day a young lady named Janet coming up to him and saying, "Father John, I would like a blessing." And so Father John is kind of in a hurry, and so he gives a kind of formal blessing. He takes his holy finger. You know, we pastors and all, we spent a lot of money to get this holy finger. You know, got to go to seminary and all that kind of stuff. And so there's power in his finger. So he took his powerful finger, and he did the sign of the cross on her head. And she said, "No, that won't work." Her words, "I want a real blessing." Well, now Father John was confused. And he said, okay, tell you tonight at chapel service, the end of the service, I'll give you a real blessing, having no idea what on earth he was going to do. So that night came. And then Father John says, and now Jenna has asked for a blessing, a special blessing, and I'd like to call her up. And she came up before he could even say very much. And she grabbed hold of him. And he had the big, long, white robe on, and he put his arms around me. You could hardly see her. She put her head against his chest, and there she was. And Father John said, Janet, you are so special here in this group. So many things you do, so many kindnesses you do to make life better for us. And we love your smile. We love the way you go around and greet people. You are so wonderful to have in this group. And we want you to know that we love you and God loves you to pieces and will never let go of you. And with that, he released her. She looked up at Father John, big smile on her face. That worked. And then the next one said, I want one of those. And so it went all 30 until finally the student intern, who sure didn't know what was going on, he said, how about me? So he got a blessing too. It's amazing what a blessing can do in a life. Now, thinking of us folks, there's so many good things we can do and are doing. I'm amazed at all of you folks. I mean, I'm humbled by the many things that you do, helping in the church, helping in the community, up to Middletown to help with projects and other things. I mean, it is just wonderful. I'm in awe. It makes a preacher kind of in awe of you're preaching to people who are living the gospel, and you are. But here's something you can do, and you know this. I know you know this. Here's something you can do that doesn't take a lot of time. It doesn't take a lot of money. It doesn't take a lot of physical work, and that is to give to others a blessing, and to say to them that they matter, that they are of worth to you, and pronounce them valuable. When we can do that, we can change a life. Dear church, we are blessed to be a blessing. Amen.
Blessing to so many of us for such a good part of our lives. We thank you very much. Dave mentioned John Newton and the great song that Newton penned from his heart, and we're going to sing to that grace this morning as well, but it's in number 2162 in our songbooks. Of course, it's on our screen. It's called Grace Alone. Let's stand as we're able.
Thank you. Lord, we thank you for your love and grace. We thank you for your promise to be with us, to never leave us. And today we remember Jean Hart. Jean passed away this last Thursday, for those of you who may not have heard that news yet. This wonderful woman who was such an example of faith and love and caring, what a beautiful smile. A woman who touched so many lives consistently, year after year. Lord, may she now find the peace that passes understanding in the arms of her Lord and in the company of her loved ones. We so thank you, Lord, for the blessing of knowing her and having her among us for so many years. Lord, we look at the long list of people's names and the prayer requests inserted in our bulletin. People who care enough to entrust us the names of themselves and of loved ones. People who are dealing with loss, with illness, with change, with needs of so many kinds. We lift these people up to you, Lord. Touch them. Guide them. Bring them the resources they need to thrive and fill them with the knowledge of you. Lord, bless today the gifts we bring. Touch our offerings and use them to bless others and to do your work in this world. Lord, as we look at the people around us this morning, as we think of the people outside this church building, Lord, people are so important. The things around us do not last. These chairs we sit on today, this beautiful building, it won't last. But people are eternal. People are what God focuses on. Lord, may we bring kindness, love, and caring to each other. May we value and support each other. May we be messengers of peace and forgiveness, vessels that both receive and pour forth your love and grace. May our lives always be truly about the Heavenly Father's business. And Lord, I ask that even the songs we've sang this morning about grace, about great is thy faithfulness, about you opening our eyes that we may see, Lord, make these not just songs we sing and then go home, but words that penetrate our hearts and penetrate our lives and lead us forward with you. Amen.
Thank you.
It is a good thing to give thanks to the Lord, to show forth thy loving kindness in the morning and thy faithfulness every night. Let us join together in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before we sing our closing song, I would like you to join me in thanking the wonderful Jan Lappin, who's been filling in for Colleen this past few weeks. We so appreciate you. Your offering music was so beautiful, and Colleen would be proud.
Amen, amen.
Jan's going to be serving on the staff here at the 11 o'clock service as the summer ends, and we're so lucky that she can stay with us, and she's also going to be leading us on Tuesday night, so we get to have her around, and that's a blessing, too. So let's stand as we're able and sing a classic oldie, David. It's a great old song, God Be With You Till We Meet Again.
Thank you.
We're shaking those Baptists all to pieces right now. Well, a couple of things. First of all, yes, in my first church, Jan and I were in Armona, near Hanford, near Layton. The Thompsons know about Layton. Near Visalia. I'm trying to expand this picture. Near Fresno. Okay. So there you get it. Anyway, they had a tradition of singing this song every single Sunday. So it was a lot of fun. Till we meet, while yelling around, singing all that kind of stuff. The other's more serious. Gene Hart. Is that a special person? You know. And, you know, she did so well. And it was her time for her. She's okay. And right over her bed, she had a picture of Bill with that beautiful smile of his. So he was smiling on her all these last days, as well as through her life. We think that service is going to be Sunday, the last Sunday of the month. I'm not sure if it's for sure, but think about it in your head. Put it in pencil, the last Sunday of this month at 2 o'clock. But you'll get further word. What did I say? Yes. Not this month, not this month. August. Names and dates are just leaving me like crazy. So, dear ones, I am not Father John. I am not a Jesuit priest. I don't have a long white robe, but I can offer a blessing. Please receive it. This is my blessing to you, that regardless of who you are, where you've been, what you've done, where the road of life has taken you thus far, God loves you. Doesn't matter what you look like, what kind of money you have, what sexual identity you have, just as you are loved by God. And we need to know, this is a blessing for me too, that wherever we go on life's journey, God is with us and will not let us go, just as God did not let Jean Hart go through all of her life. So I proclaim, dear ones, I have this on good authority. You are precious sons and daughters of the Most High God. You are blessed. Why? To be a blessing. See you later. Yeah.